we'll move on to talk about a new topic today. And the new topic for today is systemic hypertension, which is the sort of posh medical term, if you like, for high blood pressure. And a bit like the previous topic we talked about most recently, chronic kidney disease, systemic hypertension definitely falls into the categories of topics that are dear to my heart because they're important, but we can do a lot to help. So it's not, I hope, a worrying or depressing topic to talk about, but rather a topic where, you know, there is a lot we can do as carers for our pets to really look after them and hopefully protect them from some of the damaging consequences of high blood pressure, should that be an issue. As with previous sessions, if you'd like a copy of the slides I use, please just send us an email and we can send you a PDF copy of that to accompany this. And also, as with previous sessions, we will record this and it will then go onto the website, hopefully tomorrow, if you want to re-listen to it. So today, because hypertension is quite a big topic, I'm really going to focus on what I would say is the start of the story, which is understanding what we mean by the word systemic hypertension. What exactly does that mean medically? What causes it? How common is it? And then what sort of clues can carers look out for as signs that their cats may have high blood pressure? And what sort of clues do vets look out for as well? And then we'll start to prepare for blood pressure assessment, which is going to be covered in a lot more detail next week, by really preparing for the vet visit and just a little bit of discussion about that. So the first thing is to make a definition for systemic hypertension. And the medical definition of this is that it is a persistent, so a long-lasting, doesn't go away, pathological, which means associated with disease, increase in blood pressure. And it's increase in blood pressure in what's called the systemic circulation. And those of you that have any biology knowledge will know that the heart has pumps to two different circulations. There is the pulmonary circulation, the lungs, where the blood receives its oxygen and offloads its carbon dioxide. And there is the systemic circulation, which is where the blood pumps from the left side of the heart to all of the body to supply it with oxygen. And it's that part of the circulation which is affected by this condition. Hypertension is very common in people. You probably all know someone in your family or your friend circle that suffers from high blood pressure. It is incredibly common. I've put some statistics here. And you've probably also heard this term that it's often referred to as a silent killer. And what that means is that it's actually difficult to know whether you or someone you know has got high blood pressure because the symptoms, the signs of high blood pressure are often invisible until it gets very serious. And the same is unfortunately true in cats as well. So there are a few other definitions which are really important to cover at this point, and hopefully will not be too overwhelming. The first one is actually a definition which has recently in the vet world been renamed. So the new name is, I think it's a very Americanized term now, but it's situational hypertension. So what is situational hypertension? This is actually not a true hypertension. Oops, sorry. I think someone's unmuted. I'm just gonna mute them. I think that should be okay now. So situational hypertension is where stress and anxiety causes a temporary increase in blood pressure. So it's not a real genuine hypertension. It's a very temporary thing caused by fear and anxiety usually. And previously, this was often called the white coat effect or white coat hypertension. And it may well still be called that in people, but in the vet world, we're now being encouraged to call it situational hypertension. And what that means is that the cat's blood pressure isn't high normally, but in certain situations of fear and anxiety, that can make the blood pressure go up. And a classic situation for that would obviously be a visit to the vet clinic when we might be measuring blood pressure. And therefore, this is something vets really need to know about and vet nurses, because if you measure blood pressure and you get a high reading, you have to consider that it might be high because of this stress-associated or situational hypertension. And interestingly enough, as you can see lower down on this slide, some cats actually, and some people, when they're stressed, their blood pressure goes down a bit. So this is the first key message with blood pressure assessment. It's not always as black and white as we would like. But it's important for us to be aware of this stress-associated hypertension, not because it needs any treatment. It's not a pathological condition. It's just a temporary increase. So that's another key message, but mainly because it can confuse our ability to diagnose genuine high blood pressure. Two more definitions. First one is idiopathic hypertension, and idiopathic means cause unknown. So that's the first thing. And there are lots of illnesses in the world of vet medicine, but also human medicine, where you will hear idiopathic X or idiopathic Y. And all that means is we don't understand currently what has caused this condition. And idiopathic hypertension, so high blood pressure without an obvious underlying cause, does happen in cats, but is thought to be quite rare. So it's thought to affect less than 20% of cats with high blood pressure. And we don't fully understand at this stage what's causing it, hence it being called idiopathic. Various things suggested in terms of genetics, environment, and so on. And probably also some of the cats that we might put in this idiopathic category may indeed have underlying disease that's just not quite got to a point where we can actually diagnose it easily. And the obvious example of that would be kidney disease, which, as you'll see, is a very important cause of high blood pressure. And then the last definition, which is important to know about, is actually the bulk of cats with genuine hypertension have what's called a secondary hypertension. So it's thought that their high blood pressure is there in association with or because of another illness or a medical treatment which can increase the blood pressure. And that is currently thought to account for about 80% of cats with high blood pressure, or more than 80% of cats with high blood pressure. So obviously most cats with high blood pressure fall into this category. So if we put all of those things together and then try and think, well, what are the causes of hypertension? We've got a small number of cats with this idiopathic, what sometimes people would call primary hypertension, less than 20% of cats, but the majority have secondary hypertension, high blood pressure, because of or in association with another illness. And the two top contenders there, which I'll spend a little bit of time on today, are kidney disease and thyroid disease. And probably many people listening to this will have had cats with either or both of these conditions. They're pretty common conditions of older cats. There are some other conditions that are associated with high blood pressure. So one of which is a tumour often of the adrenal gland, causing what's called primary hyperaldosteronism, a tumour overproducing a hormone called aldosterone. That's uncommon, but being diagnosed more and more frequently. And some treatments that can increase blood pressure would include those used for anemia in cats with kidney disease, drugs which increase the production of red blood cells by the bone marrow, things like synthetic erythropoietin and darbepoietin, which I mentioned a little bit in last week's session on kidney disease. Another key point is that hypertension is most common in older cats. And that's perhaps not a surprise in that these common illnesses, which I've said are often associated with high blood pressure, are illnesses which are also more common in older cats. So older cats are particularly at risk. And we don't really at this stage have an awful lot of data as to how common exactly blood pressure is in the cat population, because of course many cats don't go to a vet, many cats don't have their blood pressure assessed. But this large study, which is a UK vet clinic study where they amassed data from a total of about 350,000 cats, not all of those cats had had a blood pressure assessment, but that was just the baseline population they were looking at. You can see that about 10% of cats aged between 9 and 13 and a half, where their blood pressure was assessed, were found to have high blood pressure. About a third of cats aged between 13 and a half to 18 years had high blood pressure, and even higher in cats older than that. So this and several other papers really do fit with our current thinking, which is that high blood pressure is definitely becomes more and more likely the older the cat is, and that it is quite common. So as a rough figure, about 20% of elderly cats probably have high blood pressure. So quite a significant minority of cats affected. So why is it important? Why do we care about high blood pressure? Well, same reasons as we care about it in people, in that it actually can be life-threatening. It can cause potentially fatal bleeding in the body. And that would be especially the case if bleeding happened around the brain, for example. But it also can cause a lot of other adverse events in the body, which might affect quality of life and also length of life, but in a more gradual way. And a lot of the impacts of high blood pressure is because there are certain organs, certain body systems that are particularly vulnerable to the damaging consequences of that high blood pressure. And these body systems are often referred to as target organs. So these are organs or body systems that are particularly vulnerable to the damaging effects of high blood pressure. And I've listed them here. So the eyes, the brain, and spinal cord, so the whole of the central nervous system, the heart and the blood vessels, and lastly, the kidneys. And I've already said kidney disease can cause high blood pressure, but high blood pressure is also damaging to the kidneys. So we can unfortunately get a vicious cycle of damage going on there. So what as a carer is it useful to look out for? Well, the first key message is that actually for most cats, there really isn't anything obvious to spot. And your cat with high blood pressure, just like your person with high blood pressure, may look completely fine. And therefore, it's really important for us as in veterinary professionals to encourage and recommend blood pressure screening in cats we know are at a higher risk of high blood pressure. So the cats with kidney disease, the cats with thyroid disease, the older cats where possible. But for you as a carer, often, sadly, there won't be any signs of high blood pressure because it is this invisible illness. But there are signs in some cats, and those signs can include clues of hypertension, which we'll look at first, but also probably more often clues of the cause of that high blood pressure. So for example, clues of kidney disease, clues of thyroid disease. And if you see any of these, definitely contact your vet and ask them for advice in terms of further assessments. So firstly, what are the clues of hypertensive damage? Well, I've already mentioned that there are these four target organs that are particularly vulnerable to damaging consequences of high blood pressure. And that's the eyes, the brain and the spinal cord, what we call the central nervous system, the kidneys and the heart. So if we look at each of these in turn now and point out the sorts of things that possibly might be visible to you as a carer, let's start with the eyes. So damage caused by high blood pressure in the eyes typically can cause bleeding in the eyes and swelling. Retinal detachment of the seeing layer at the back of the eye is a common consequence. And so if you as a carer firstly ever see your cat appearing to have any problems with their eyesight, and particularly if they seem to have happened very suddenly, that would be really a key time to pick up the phone and speak to your vet urgently, because the sooner the cat can have a blood pressure assessment and start blood pressure treatment, the best the chance of regaining some vision. Having said that, actually, there is some good data that even cats that have been blind for weeks to months actually can regain vision with appropriate treatment of their high blood pressure. So don't panic if for any reason, you know, it's not possible to contact the vet immediately, but do contact them as soon as you possibly can. Sometimes, but less often, you might actually see bleeding in the eye yourself. So that bottom photo just shows an example of what an eye can look like. It's not terribly common, but if you do see any blood in your cat's eye, again, that would be a time to speak to your vet as soon as possible. Bleeding and swelling around the brain or the spinal cord can cause a variety of neurological and behavioural signs, and in the very mild cases it's behavioral signs, and again, thinking in particular of older cats, if your cat's behavior seems to change, then this is one of the possible causes. There are definitely other possible causes, but definitely consider high blood pressure. So for example, if your cat starts to become very vocal, especially at night, meowing at the night without apparently good reason, if they seem to be a bit forgetful, perhaps forgetting where their litter box is or where their food bowl is, or perhaps looking a little bit aimless, you know, wandering into a room and looking a bit like they're confused, one of the possibilities would be hypertension. As I've mentioned, there are definitely other important causes to consider as well, though. So this is not the only thing that will cause that. And then in more severe cases, if you do get a large amount of bleeding or swelling, it can cause quite dramatic, often sudden and serious neurological changes. So, for example, if your cat had what looked like a seizure, or if your cat collapsed or was unconscious, then high blood pressure would be a possible cause of that as well. I already mentioned that high blood pressure can both be caused by kidney disease, but also high blood pressure can damage the kidney disease. So as a carer, evidence of that you might spot at home would include, for example, some of the signs of kidney disease that we talked about in previous weeks, a cat that's drinking more, drinking a larger volume per day, passing more urine per day, perhaps having a poor appetite, and other changes as well. So of course, those might be clues. And then lastly, the other target organ to mention is the heart and the blood vessels. Damage to these is less visible on the outside, so it's often not something that a carer is able to spot. But this is where, when a veterinary professional examines your cat, there may be clues that are apparent. And those clues would include things like a new heart murmur. So if your cat all its life it never had a heart murmur, suddenly when it's gone in for its annual health check, the vet hears a heart murmur, one of the possible causes of this would be hypertension. Again, there are other possible causes as well. And similarly, an abnormal heart rhythm can be caused by high blood pressure as well. So those are the clues associated with hypertensive damage. The next set of clues are associated with underlying disease. Kidney disease we've already spoken about quite a lot, but this is just a reminder of the sorts of things that we might see. And also in terms of the frequency of high blood pressure, it's thought that up to 60% of cats with kidney disease will develop high blood pressure. So quite a, you know, really significant number. And therefore, if you do have a cat with kidney disease, it's really worth discussing blood pressure assessment and monitoring with your vet clinic. Hyperthyroidism is another illness which often is associated with high blood pressure. The nature of the relationship between these two illnesses is still a little bit under debate, in that it doesn't seem to be a simple cause and effect situation, in that there are options for treating hyperthyroidism that can completely cure this condition, and still many cats that have developed high blood pressure, even when their hyperthyroidism is cured, will still need medication for their high blood pressure. So it's not a simple sort of switch on, switch off scenario, but certainly, again, it's an example of an illness where it's really important, where at all possible, to consider high blood pressure as a possible complication of the hyperthyroidism. And hyperthyroidism is an illness which, again, is quite common in older cats, affects about 10% of older cats. And cats like us have thyroid glands within their neck. And this condition develops where there is an overgrowth of that thyroid tissue. Usually it's a benign overgrowth, so it's not caused by a cancerous growth, but that overgrowth of thyroid tissue increases blood levels of thyroid hormones. And one of the impacts of that, or one of the associations of that, can be that blood pressure is also increased. And other things to look out for as signs of hyperthyroidism would include weight loss. Both of these cats, you can see, look pretty thin. Coat changes, also quite common. And often these cats are very, very hungry, or at the very least have a normal appetite. So if you have a cat that seems to be eating quite well and the weight is falling off them, hyperthyroidism is definitely high on the list. Again, there are other possible causes as well. behavioral changes can be caused by hypothyroidism as well. So I talked about hypertension causing behavioral changes, but hypothyroidism can also independently affect behavior. So there's a bit of overlap there. Often as well, gastrointestinal signs, things like vomiting, diarrhea, some increase in thirst, although usually not as severe as a cat with kidney disease. Again, the nighttime vocalization can be seen with hypothyroidism as well as with high blood pressure. So another area of overlap there. But the good news is that hypothyroidism is a very treatable condition. There are a number of different ways that you can manage it. And I'm sure we will in a later Cat Cafe come back to hypothyroidism as a topic, because again, it's another important one to consider. Coming back to hypertension, what other clues might the vet find as clues of hypertension? Well, when it comes to the eyes, we can look at the eyes and we can look at the back of the eyes using special equipment, which means that we can actually directly visualize blood vessels and we can see areas of bleeding, areas of detachment. And that can be incredibly helpful when it comes to confirming a diagnosis of hypertension. We can also look for neurological changes. We can do a neurological examination, although that on its own is not diagnostic for high blood pressure, but it may give us some useful clues. We may hear some clues when examining the heart, as talked about earlier on. And then from a laboratory perspective, we can get clues regarding kidney function from our blood and urine tests. And from a urine perspective, often we find cats with high blood pressure have increased amounts of protein in their urine because their poor little kidneys are being blasted with blood at high pressure, and that's forcing more protein through into the urine. So that can be a clue of hypertension as well as something that we look for in cats with kidney disease. So when I'm speaking to veterinary professionals, vets and nurses, about hypertension, this is my sort of list of times to make sure that you have a blood pressure monitor available and that you actually monitor and measure blood pressure. And you can see it's quite a long list of possibilities. So it's any cat that has problems with their eyesight, visual deficits, cats with ocular lesions, so eye lesions consistent with high blood pressure, such as bleeding in the eye or retinal detachment, all of those conditions where we know there's any possible association, like kidney disease, hypothyroidism, cats where we find this increased amount of protein in their urine, because as I just mentioned, that is often seen associated with hypertension as well. If we hear abnormal heart rhythms, we should definitely assess blood pressure. If we've done a heart ultrasound and we can see some of that remodeling of the heart that occurs in association with hypertension, then again, we should check blood pressure. And in cats with behavioral or neurological signs, we should check blood pressure. In addition to that list, I very much encourage clinics to include a blood pressure assessment as part of routine wellness screening in older cats. And I'll show you the International Cat Care Guidelines in the next slide, which include recommendations for blood pressure assessments that I also recommend to clinics. And last but not least would be if in an older cat you're doing some elective surgery, for example, dental surgery or anything else that really needs an anaesthetic in particular, then I think a blood pressure assessment should be part of that pre-anaesthetic health check. So not just blood tests, ideally blood tests, urine tests and a blood pressure check, if at all possible. So these are the International Cat Care Guidelines, what they call their Cat Care for Life. I've put the website at the bottom, just above the Vet Professionals logo, and you can visit that site and see their resources, their checklists and information. And essentially what these guidelines do is they provide advice for owners and veterinary professionals as to how often healthy cats, apparently healthy cats, should be assessed and what tests should be done. And the key point really is that as cats get older, in the same way as is the case in ourselves, then it is appropriate to do slightly different assessments. So as in the case in Scotland where I live, for example, when you reach the grand age of 50, whether you're male or female, you get a letter in the post inviting you to send them a sample of your faeces for occult blood testing, which is for bowel cancer. And that's just something that everyone in Scotland gets at the age of 50. And I think I've had one, so there you go. But you get reminders thereafter, or every 2 or 3 years, I think it is, you get repeat ones. So that is just a very normal age-related health screening example. In England, it's actually age 60 that you get that letter. So there are some regional differences within the UK. And I know there are people listening as well that are from around the world. So there will be different equivalents, I'm sure, in your countries. But the key point is that we're all used to age-related health screening. And the same is true in cats. And when it comes to blood pressure assessments, what's recommended is that we, where possible, include this as part of our annual six-monthly check in our older cats. So from the age of 7 upwards, if possible, we include a blood pressure check. But it's particularly important in my mind for those cats in the senior and super senior age categories, those cats aged 11 years and over. Those are the ones where we're very likely to find a significant number have high blood pressure. Not that many 7-year-olds have high blood pressure. But it's a good opportunity, if you can, to start assessing at that point, because it gets you and your cat used to the procedure and what it involves, and gives an opportunity for discussion with your vet as to why it's important, and reinforce all those messages. You'll see there are some other health related guidelines with respect to different ages of cats, but I just wanted to highlight the blood pressure one for today. So next week, I'm going to talk about how we assess blood pressure, and the two ways that we assess blood pressure include measuring blood pressure where at all possible, and also looking at the eyes for evidence of hypertensive damage, because that can be incredibly helpful. But as I mentioned at the very, very start of today's presentation, we know that cats can get this what is called situational hypertension, or stress associated hypertension. And this is something that, well, we don't know precisely how common it is, but our feeling is that it is quite common, and it can really confuse diagnosis. So I just wanted to finish with a few starting tips, really, for reducing stress in our cats, that hopefully means that when their blood pressure is assessed, we get as reliable, accurate, and representative readings as possible. And the first thing that I think is worth mentioning is that if you are having to take your cat to a vet clinic, you will have some sort of carrier for your cat. But unfortunately, not all carriers are equal in terms of my view of their usefulness in terms of visits to the vet clinic. Every carrier, of course, needs to be secure so the cat can't escape, and the cat needs to feel safe. But advantages for carriers in terms of the vet visit are that they should be easy to get a cat in and out of without any sort of struggle. And so that's why I've put a tick next to the two boxes on the left. One is it's a very boring looking basket that has that top opening, which is very large. You just do not need to fight with the cat in any way to get it in or out of that carrier. For cats that like to leap out of that carrier before you've quite shut the lid, then having a towel handy that you can just gently put over the cat while you lower the lid will stop them from being able to leap out and run away. The second carrier, more typical carrier used in clinics, is absolutely fine, because whilst it only has a small door at the front, you can see it's very easy to take apart. It's got these, it's probably, I think, 4 of these clips, which mean you can really easily take the lid off it. And that often is a really great way of, for those cats that don't want to come out in the clinic, which is absolutely understandable, that then allows us, without, again, any sort of struggle or any sort of worry, to very gently examine the cat. And in fact, they can stay in the base of their carrier and have their blood pressure assessment there. And that's absolutely fine. I'm not so keen on the other options, partly because in the example of the first one, the soft carrier, whilst they're easy to get cats out of, if the cat doesn't really want to go into it, because they're very soft and flexible, these carriers, that can be a bit trickier. And some of them, the base of that carrier is very soft, and it's not very stable and secure feeling, I think, for the cat being carried in. And the wicker basket one on the far right, again, would not be an easy one for a veterinary professional, because if the cat doesn't want to come out of that tiny hole, you are going to have a very, very difficult task to try and extract it. And you may need to, if the cat's injured and needs urgent treatment, of course, you just have to do your best. But thinking of a cat having a blood pressure assessment, you really don't want your consultation to start with you having to extract a cat from its carrier. So getting a nice carrier is, I think, a good first step. And ideally at home, you shouldn't do what most people do, and I will include myself in this, which is your carrier lives perhaps in your garden shed, in your attic, or in some sort of dusty understairs cupboard where perhaps, you know, there are spiders' webs and all sorts, and you bring it out once a year for your cat to go in. That is going to be an alien, unfamiliar basket for the cat, but also the cat is just going to totally associate that with going to the vets or going to the cattery. So if you can have a carrier which really lives in your house, preferably in an area that your cat uses, and ideally even is somewhere the cat likes to spend time, that's even better. And that perhaps is another reason to have one of those easy to detach carriers, the ones where you can lift the lid off, because then you can leave it with the lid off as a bed for the cat in the house. It can have treats and toys in there, and the cat knows, you know, this is a place that I'm happy to be. And there is some evidence as well, so I'm just going to look at muting here. We've got a dog trying to contribute to the discussion, which is quite amusing. This paper is a fairly recent paper where they actually looked at training cats to be comfortable with their carriers. So tactics such as those I've put on the slide to really encourage the cats to view their cat basket as somewhere that was, you know, familiar and safe and not threatening, and it does actually reduce the stress levels. So if you know you're going to be having lots of vet visits with your cats, if it's had health problems, then this is the sort of thing that can help make a difference. And you may well have heard of Feliway, which is a synthetic cat pheromone preparation. It's a synthetic pheromone that cats produce in their cheek glands and that they rub on you and rub on walls when they're feeling sort of safe and reassured. Well, Feliway is a synthetic version of that, and you can get a spray formulation of that, which you can spray in the basket and on the bedding before the cat is introduced. Must be done 20 or 30 minutes before the cat comes near it, because there's a, I think it's an alcohol carrier, which the cat would definitely not like, but basically you want it to sort of settle in, and that too will help the cat to feel a little bit reassured on their travel to the journey. And you can spray the Feliway in your car if you want as well. And then hopefully the journey to the vet clinic is as calm and stress-free as possible. And we will talk next week in more detail about exactly how we assess blood pressure. But again, the emphasis is on really calm and quiet situation. Definitely I'm a fan of you being present to reassure your cat, and we do it in as gentle and calm a way as possible. If you're keen to find out more and you don't want to wait till next week as to what is involved, then if you go to the video tutorial page of Vet Professionals, which is under the helpful info menu, there is a video of my own cat, Sooty, a black and white cat, having his blood pressure measured, that talks through the technique. And you'll see he doesn't look completely impressed, but he's also extremely good at having his blood pressure assessed, and it's not a traumatic experience for a cat to experience. So we'll talk more about that next week. But for today, I just really wanted to focus on introducing this topic, explaining what it means, why it's worrying to cats, what we can do as carers to try and identify cats that might benefit from a blood pressure screening. Also very much encourage you to follow any invitations you get from your vet clinic to attend health checks, you know, healthy cat checks, as well as obviously taking your cats when you're worried about them. Of course, at the moment, still with the COVID situation that we're in at the time of recording this, then you will not, probably in most countries, certainly not in the UK, be able to go in for a routine blood pressure assessment just yet. But hopefully normality will resume in the coming weeks, and that will become possible again. And next week, we'll talk more about how we assess blood pressure, and then, of course, finish off with some information on treatment as well. And again, other resources that you might find useful would include, there are two scientific papers for those of you that are medically minded or particularly keen, that I've put a screenshot of on the right-hand side of this slide. They're free to download for anyone. You don't need to have a subscription to these journals. So if you Google ISFM consensus guidelines and ACVIM consensus guidelines, you should be able to see these. And if you're particularly interested in this topic, you might find that helpful. But also, don't forget the video tutorial that I just mentioned. That is something you can look at straight away. And I'll stop at this point, and very happily take questions, and also happy to talk about other aspects of hypertension that perhaps don't relate to today's session, if you're just, you know, desperate for certain key bits of information. But please feel free to unmute yourself or to type a question in the chat box, which to access the chat box for me, it comes under the more options. So I'm just going to open the chat box so I can see it. Then whatever suits you, please feel free to ask away.